many people are familiar with Morgan Stanley, or you've at least heard of him? Okay, good. All right, great. So, I don't like lecturing, and I would actually prefer to have a more interactive discussion, but while they're getting the presentation up, because I do have some slides that just describe what Morgan Stanley is a bit more thoroughly, I'd like to find out a little bit about you, because I'm not 100% sure what your background is, what your areas of study are. So would anyone like to just give me an idea so I can get a sampling of kind of what your interests are and kind of where you are?
My name's Mike. I'm from 15 minutes from here.
Okay.
I'm a finance major, right? I'm minor in wealth management. I want to go towards investment banking as a career path.
Okay. Excellent.
Hello, my name is Ian Welt. I am an accounting major. I'm hoping to eventually get my CPA and going to get a lucrative job in the field of public accounting.
Okay. Excellent.
My name is Kara. I'm majoring in finance and accounting and minoring in wealth management. I'm a sophomore right now, and I actually just interned at Morgan Stanley.
You did an internship?
I did an internship.
Oh, awesome.
Yeah, I'm sort of the Kelly Group in Florida Park.
Okay.
And yeah, right now I'm just trying to decide to go the finance route or accounting route, because I want to get my CFP and CPA.
I see. All right, awesome. Anyone else? Okay.
I'm Aubrey Wolfram. I'm a junior. I'm an accounting major, and I want to become a CPA and go towards the tax route, because I'm doing a tax internship right now. So.
Very interesting. It's a lot of stuff happening in the tax space, especially even within Morgan Stanley right now. By any chance, is anyone here studying technology, or is that not who? It's okay. I'm just asking. No? Okay. All right, so are you more or less all in the sort of finance accounting area? And I guess that's true here as well?
If I unmute them for a second.
Sorry?
They're currently muted, so that you can hear them if they were speaking. I was mentioning for him to unmute them for a second.
Okay.
It's the red button at the bottom.
Let me just start by giving you a little bit of my background. Okay. I am in technology. I've been in technology since I can remember, many, many years, like over 25 years I spent in technology. I've been at Morgan Stanley since August of 2015. Prior to Morgan Stanley, I worked for Goldman Sachs. I'm assuming you've probably heard of Goldman Sachs. And I was also in the technology division there. I was at Goldman Sachs for 18 years. Prior to that, I was still in technology my whole life. But I worked at for a consulting firm for what was then Coopers & Lybrand, but the company has changed. And Coopers & Lybrand was one of the big eight accounting firms. However, they had a technology practice, and I was a consultant assigned to an account where we were actually building inventory management applications and accounting applications. So over the course of my career, I've worked on a variety of different types of systems. And while, you know, my focus has been on designing the technology that supported the business, as part of that, it became really important for me to understand the business. And, you know, you're talking to people, whether they're in finance, whether they were in accounting, and there's a group in the investment banking. So let me just explain something. So let me just query. When you hear the term investment banking, what does that mean to you? What is that? Can someone tell me what investment banking is?
Spending to make more than you spend.
You always want to make more than you spend, for sure. Are they on mute? I don't know if I can interact with them, if I can hear them.
Metro, can you hear us?
They're probably just on mute, yeah.
Yeah, we're just muted at this end.
Okay, but I just want to get a sense, to kind of understand what your idea of investment banking is. And And I do have some slides, but while they're pulling them up, I just... Yes?
Any of you answer? Go ahead.
Hello? Can you hear me?
I can certainly hear you.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Well, it's like wealth management, dealing with stocks, bonds, mutual funds.
Yes, it's exactly right. I mean, there's the whole world of investing. And unlike what we refer to as retail banks, which would be like TD Bank or Citibank, and you see businesses like JP Morgan Chase, which has like bank branches, there's an aspect of retail banking where they're serving the general public and people have checking accounts and saving accounts and, you know, you're kind of holding your money there. Investment banking is a bit different. It's essentially a form of banking where the organization itself is responsible for moving capital in order to fund the economy, right? So when you talk about the clients of an investment bank, while there are individuals who would be served from the wealth management arm of an investment bank, the investment bank itself has clients that are governments and pension funds and very large institutions. On one side of the equation, there are organizations like hedge funds that have large client bases with huge amounts of capital. And on the other side, there is governments and other organizations like that, corporations, who need capital to fund their business and to fund their activities. And the investment bank is sitting in the middle, orchestrating the exchange of capital from one hand to the other. And that exchange usually happens through a transfer of assets. So, as was mentioned, there are stocks and bonds and other types of instruments that are more or less sold to those that are interested in growing their portfolio, investing their money, and the money that they provide is then given to the other organizations like governments and corporations that need that money to operate their business. So the investment bank is the institution that's sitting in between other large institutions facilitating the exchange of capital. There are companies that are privately held, and I'm sure you've heard about Snapchat, for example, that recently went public, right? So they had an initial public offering. Well, that initial public offering happens through a process that they call syndication. And what that is effectively is that an investment bank is working with Snapchat as a representative, and they go out to all of these large institutional investors who are interested in buying Snapchat shares, and so they sell the shares as part of a initial public offering, and then that money is given to Snapchat to fund its business. Okay, and subsequent to that, once the Snapchat shares are sold, there is a secondary market, which is represented by the New York Stock Exchange or, you know, the NASDAQ, which are public exchanges where the securities of that organization are then publicly traded by people like you and me or other major investors. And so the investment bank is the organization that's facilitating the initial public offering, and they're syndicating the company that wants to sell their shares on the open market. Hopefully you're following what I'm saying, but the investment bank operates, you know, at the level of billions and trillions, if you will, in terms of facilitating the exchange of cash and assets, whereas retail banks are usually dealing in hundreds and millions, like so at a more public, you know, private individual level. Is that somewhat clear? So when I hear someone say that they're in finance or they're studying finance and they want to work in the investment banking world, if you want to work in the area of tax or you want to work in a trading organization, you know, you're really getting involved in the processes that have to do with the exchange of assets. So someone wanting to sell security or financial instruments, which could be stocks or bonds. There are something called structured products where someone puts together a portfolio of assets. It could be mortgages, for example, and they sell that pool of mortgages as a single security. And so there's this whole process of securitization that happens. And Morgan Stanley is one of these very large investment banks. Goldman Sachs is another investment bank. JP Morgan, while they have Chase branches, they also have, you know, JP Morgan itself, because it's really JP Morgan slash Chase. So there's Chase Bank, and then there's JP Morgan, which is actually an investment bank. Citibank, also a very large institution that has an investment banking business and also has a retail banking business. And so when you're thinking about your career and you're thinking about going into investment banking, you have to realize that is a very broad, it's a very broad statement. And there are so many different areas that one could go into, everything from figuring out what a, you know, how to make a new security and introduce it to the market. You could be a part of a deal team that's helping a company to go public. You could be working in the area of corporate tax because the investment bank itself has to pay taxes. You know, the business itself, so all the clients of that business, there are tax implications when there are an exchange of assets. There are people in operations who once a trade is booked, but once a trade happens, there's a whole set of processes that go on in the process of sort of recording that trade and also managing that asset over the course of its life, if you will. And so, you know, I'm gonna go through these slides very quickly, but what I'd like to do is have a bit more interaction with you because, at least from my standpoint, I think to get perhaps a clearer understanding, unless you've done an internship and you actually worked in one of these organizations and you know everything already, you know, I think a good format for doing this might be to have, I want to get to the question and answers as soon as possible. So let me go through these slides to give you a sense of what Morgan Stanley is about. And I think when you see this, the one thing that I'll say is that while Morgan Stanley is different from Goldman Sachs, it's different from JP Morgan, it's different from Citibank, it's different from Barclays, it's different from other banks, in terms of being an investment bank, they're all kind of in the same business. One other thing I want to say before I get into this is that there is a distinction between institutional investing and wealth management. And that distinction primarily is who the client is. So institutional investing has to do with institutions, pension funds, hedge funds, that want to buy or sell securities. Wealth management is generally high net worth individuals who want to invest their money and they have a financial advisor, someone who is, you know, either investing on their behalf or advising them on how to manage a fairly large sum of money. So someone like Bill Gates or Oprah Winfrey or, you know, the head of Facebook or any, you know, person like a multimillionaire is someone that would be considered a wealth management client because they are essentially enlisting the help of financial advisors to help them manage their wealth. It's not to say that you or I couldn't have a financial advisor, which you know you certainly could, but there's sort of a different level of sophistication that's involved with managing the portfolio of someone who has millions and millions of dollars versus someone that has hundreds or thousands or hundreds of thousands of dollars. It's just certain investment vehicles that you can participate in when you have lots of money versus those who may not have as much at their disposal to invest. So hopefully that's clear. So let me go through this. Who is Morgan Stanley? So Morgan Stanley is an investment bank. And as you can see here, there's over 55,000 employees in 747 offices around the world, 42 countries. And me personally, for example, as a managing director of IT, I have teams that are in multiple locations. So this Saturday, believe it or not, I'm traveling to Mumbai, India, because I have a team of people out in India. Several weeks ago, I was in Tokyo, because I have, you know, people that I work with that are in Tokyo, in Asia. And there are many people like me who, because of the breadth of the business, you know, we go out and we travel and we engage with various business people that we serve who are in these various offices around the world. So, huge company with that is in fact a global organization, both from an investment banking and a wealth management perspective, meaning that there are high net worth individuals in Asia and in Europe who are clients of Morgan Stanley, and there are institutions like hedge funds and corporations and governments around the world who leverage the services of Morgan Stanley. Okay, I'm not going to go through this whole history. I will tell you that Goldman Sachs has one of these because they've been in business, you know, whatever, over 100 years. Morgan Stanley obviously has been in business since the 1930s through the current year. Very, you know, there's been a lot of change that has happened over that time as the business has grown. And, you know, this is really just meant to show how that growth has happened over the years. This, in fact, is a very important slide. And I just want to pause for a second because I will tell you this. When, you know, every major business has their mission, has their core values that they, that actually are the underpinnings of the culture in that organization. And generally speaking, the people who work at Morgan Stanley, like at other investment banks, their thought process is largely guided by the core principles of that firm. And each firm has its own culture, the same way that individuals have a certain belief system and certain culture. In the case of Morgan Stanley, the culture is really underpinned by these four ideas, these core values. Number one is putting clients first. And this, I'm just going to say it might sound fluffy, but it's actually not fluffy. It's very serious. Putting clients first, always keeping the client's interest first, working with other colleagues to make sure that you're delivering the best that you can deliver to every single client. You know, really listening to what the needs are of the client and responding to those needs. So this is actually the reason why people in my role have to travel, because it's not enough to just be talking on the phone to someone or doing a video conference with someone. You actually need to go out and meet with your clients, with your counterparts, with the people who you're serving, no matter what your role is. You might be in tax, you might be in accounting, you might be in IT, you might be in operations, you might be in the trading organization. There are people who go out and meet with clients, whether your clients are internal to the company or whether the clients that you're talking about are the external clients that are leveraging the services of that firm. And so listening to the client, understanding the client's needs, and being able to the next thing, lead with exceptional ideas to formulate strategies that help to service and to further the needs of that client, whether it's an individual investor who's trying to grow their portfolio, whether it's someone who is thinking about the legacy that they're leaving for their family, whether it is a corporation that is trying to fund their business or to come to the market with a new product, whether it's a government that's trying to build new roads or bridges that need funding, whether it is a hedge fund who is looking to invest in various financial instruments in order to help the clients of that hedge fund to grow their portfolio over the years. Like, there are so many dimensions to this. And it really all comes down to leading with exceptional ideas, really understanding the needs of the client, and being able to bring everything that is at your own disposal and to use all of the resources of the firm in such a way where you can deliver best-in-class service to the client and all of the companies. Morgan Stanley is a leading investment bank in the world. Goldman Sachs is a leading investment bank in the world. JP Morgan is a leading investment bank. And they all have their areas of particular expertise. And there are some banks that are, leaders in one area as opposed to being leaders in another. Like, for example, the wealth management business at Morgan Stanley far exceeds the magnitude of the wealth management business at Goldman Sachs. The prime brokerage business, which is effectively a trading business within Morgan Stanley that services hedge funds, is much larger and is considered to be number one in the marketplace over the other investment banks. But then, you'll have Goldman Sachs or JP Morgan that might be a leader in certain dimensions, of the business or in a certain market. So they're all competing, and the competition really centers around leading with exceptional ideas around how to bring investing ideas to the marketplace so that either those on the buy side who are looking to buy securities investments to, because they believe that the value of those investments is going to go up, or whether it's those who are on the sell side, meaning those who are looking to get capital to do something, whether it's to build a bridge or to come to the market with a new product, you have organizations on both sides with the investment bank sitting in the middle facilitating the exchange of these assets. Is that clear so far? So doing the right thing is, there's not enough that can be said about that. I'm sure perhaps you remember what happened in 2007 and 2008 with sort of what they refer to as the financial crisis, right? Where there was, in effect, a financial downturn that was the result of what was framed as Wall Street selling certain mortgage-based products to the marketplace, and the value of those investments went down, and there was a big problem in the economy, and as a result of that, there was a huge amount of regulation that was created to help have more controls over these types of things happening in the economy. And so doing the right thing, acting with integrity, thinking like an owner, honesty and all of these other things is just true anyway, because you're dealing with people's money and you just have to have a high degree of ethical behavior with respect to that. However, there's also this regulatory overlay in the entire industry, which is creating a set of standards that all of these institutions must adhere to in order to conduct business. And there are people whose job it is to make sure that the firm is adhering to all of these regulations. There's a compliance department. In fact, tax is a big it's considered to be a regulatory aspect. There are rules that govern the types of transactions that you can do with different types of institutions. There are rules that govern how you can, who you can sell certain types of assets to and the types of transactions that you can do. So doing the right thing comes down to really understanding the regulatory and the legal landscape within and the context within which business happens in the economy. And when I say in the economy, yes, in the US, but it's more like the global economy because, in effect, things that happen here in the US impact what happens in Asia and impacts what happens in, in Europe. And so it's all connected, right? And when a major institution like, one of these investment banks has a fallout, it can affect the global economy. I mean, we're dealing with trillions of dollars in value. And so it's very important that there is a standard of ethics that we adhere to. And this is, it's incumbent upon us. So if you're thinking about going into the investment banking world, this is just something that you need to understand, that you're going to be beholden to understand and to comply with a lot of rules that govern the way we, the way we do what we do. And the last thing here is giving back. So this is a form of giving back, right? Having people who are in this business come and talk to the next generation of people who are looking to enter the investment banking world. Giving back also has to do with programs that the firm has, which are specifically geared at just going out into the community and helping, whether it's programs like Habitat for Humanity, where we will take time out and just volunteer and help to pay for the construction of homes in certain neighborhoods, or whether it is us leveraging our knowledge and expertise as individuals going out to schools, whether it could be very young people in grade school, just helping them to understand certain things and teaching. I mean, there's all sort of forms of giving back, but I spend a little time on this because it often sounds fluffy, but it's really very important. And as students thinking about entering the marketplace, I just want you to understand that these core values exist in every firm, and you should embrace them because that's what enables you to be effective in working at a firm like Morgan Stanley, for sure. So I had alluded to this previously. Who are the clients? Morgan Stanley develops financial products on behalf of government agencies, whether it be federal, state, or local level agencies, corporations, and large financial institutions. On the other side, the capital is distributed to hedge funds, pension funds, insurance companies, and individuals. And as you can see in the middle, there are various types of financial instruments, whether they be equity or debt, mergers and acquisitions, derivative products. There's foreign exchange, because sometimes people want to, they want to buy pound sterling with US dollars because they think that the value or the exchange rate between pound sterling and US dollars is going to be such that if they own pound sterlings, they will make more money, and at some point they can, have more US dollars when they exchange it back. So there's a whole foreign exchange business. Real estate, you look around and you see these very large properties. Like, for example, when I was at Goldman Sachs, there is a, in Linden, New Jersey, there is this energy plant. They call it the cogeneration plant. And it's this huge, landscape, and it just looks like, it looks like one of these energy plants where there's just like smoke billowing up in the air. And I didn't realize that Goldman Sachs owned that plant. Right? And so I would drive past there every day, and then at one time I was like, oh, Goldman Sachs owned that. And so Morgan Stanley, JP Morgan, all these all these companies not only owning their big, you know, multi skyscraper buildings wherever they might be, but there's a whole real estate business that they're involved with. And these are products that are used as financial instruments to help those that are seeking to make money invest, and those that need money to have the assets that they need to run their businesses. And then commodities, which is like oil and different types of, you know, metals like copper. There's a whole business around that. And as you can see, there's the exchange of capital for securities, and there's also something called advisory services. And this is where a hedge fund or an individual or a company needs advice on how to invest, like what are the best products to invest in. There's a whole advisory business that Morgan Stanley has. So this is getting more into technology, and the reason why this is important is because firms like Morgan Stanley in particular, and every other major investment bank on the street, is not able to do what they do without technology. Technology is very much a part of the business. In fact, at Morgan Stanley, I think the number is, we spend $3.2 billion on technology every year, just to give you a sense of how important it is. And so, as there are different parts of the business, there are different areas of technology aligned to those businesses. And as you can see here, there's an institutional security division, there's prime brokerage, funding and finance, there's operations compliance technology, which happens to be the division that I'm in. There's wealth management technology, and then there's investment management technology, which is generally the asset management business. And then there are these sort of enterprise-wide areas of technology, like networking, that serves enterprise infrastructure. I mean, it's very vast. But this is, the technology division is effectively the enabler for business. And, you know, when you think about trades being done, like on the New York Stock Exchange or on the NASDAQ, you know, the trading that happens today largely happens through technology. There are computers that are actually executing and sending trades back and forth. There's something called high frequency trading, and it really does matter, like, how close the computer is to the exchange where the trade is happening, because things are happening in sub-millisecond time frames. So when you're looking at, I don't know, the Wall Street Journal, and you're thinking about buying some shares of Snapchat, trust me, there are computers that are way ahead that are making some very sophisticated decisions, you know, at the level of millions of shares and more about, you know, what to trade in and what not to trade in. And so there's, you know, technology is underpinning everything that we do. And just as Morgan Stanley is a global firm from the standpoint of its businesses, we have technology centers around the world that are, the footprint is designed to serve the businesses in various regions. I'm not going to go through this in too much depth, but it's worthy to note that, you know, as I said, Morgan Stanley is a leading investment bank. And as you can see here, there are various types of awards that the firm has received as a result of its ability to lead with exceptional ideas and to do the right thing and to serve its clients and to develop technology to bring products to the marketplace that enable the economy to fund itself. And so these are examples of the awards that Morgan Stanley has itself, you know, garnered. And, you know, this is very, very important, not only from a reputational standpoint, but as a statement and a verification of how hard the firm works to deliver best-in-class service. So this is a part that you might be interested in. I don't know. There are intern and full-time programs at Morgan Stanley. And yes, you know, this is framed a little bit from the technology division standpoint because I'm in technology, but trust me, every division within the firm has an intern and analyst, an intern analyst program. And, you know, what this is really speaking to is the types of activities, so professional networking, mentoring, you know, really being able to engage with senior leaders and hear them talk about what they do and how they do it. There's professional development, there's, you know, showcasing of the various projects and activities of the firm. And, you know, when I joined Morgan Stanley, okay, I didn't come in through the intern analyst program because I'm what you call a lateral hire, meaning I was in another company as a senior person and I was hired. And so I didn't come in through the analyst program, but every year we have people such as yourselves who come into the firm to have an experience, and it could be just for a few months or weeks, as an intern to kind of get context. And I will ask you, I mean, you did an internship at Morgan Stanley.
Yes.
Would you mind just, I don't know, telling your colleagues here what that was like?
Sure, so I interned in a wealth management group. I worked under three financial advisors and about two CSAs. It was more an ops internship with some like assisting the financial advisors themselves. But there, they introduced me to every department that was in the building. So I worked with HR sometimes. Sometimes we would cover the switchboards. And there, I saw how in detail we were involved in the clients' lives. And like you were saying, we have some people there who have maybe about $30,000 in assets up to about $30 million.
Yeah.
So wealth management really is for everybody, and it's something to consider in your future. You know, maybe the one step above contacting a financial advisor for your needs would be wealth management. And I definitely recommend checking out financial advisory and wealth management as internships, because even from there's an accounting department at every company. So
yes, yes, and it's a tremendously valuable experience, whether you end up working at Morgan Stanley or not. You know, it's highly valuable for you to seek internships, you know, at Morgan Stanley or at other investment banking firms, so that you can get the context and you can get firsthand experience on what it's like to work at a place like this. Yes.
So for for the IT, are you looking just for people with computer skills, or do you look for people with different backgrounds also?
That's an excellent question. Let me see if I can answer this in the best possible way. One of the things that I enjoy in life is being a musician. And so I'm a technologist, but I'm also a musician. I play saxophone. And believe it or not, my thought process as a musician plays very much into my thought process as a technologist. And what you will find is that, so for example, in the technology division, to your question, yes, there is a need to have certain aptitude for computer programming if that's the area of technology that you're going into. And generally, your program of study at Fairleigh Dickinson should have included some degree of programming for you to sort of go into that. But there are many, many people who have had no programming experience who came into the technology division. There are people who have a background in engineering or in, you know, psychology that work in either technology or work in other areas of the firm, wealth management or in operations. And so you shouldn't feel like you have to have a background solely in technology and be steeped in that and steeped in math in order to have a role in the technology division. The same way that if you have a background in accounting, you know, or if you have a background in tax, you might work in the tax area, but once you come into the firm, you might find that there's another area of the firm that can utilize not just your skills, but your aptitude. Right, your ability to think critically, which is incredibly important. And generally, there's sort of two dimensions that the firm looks at when it's considering hiring someone. One is your skills and your aptitude. The other is how well you fit into the firm from a cultural standpoint, meaning are you a team player? Or are you more a person who likes to sit behind the screen and not talk to anybody and just do things on your own? Like there are people that just have natural personality traits that make them more suitable for certain types of jobs than others. And so we're generally looking at people from the standpoint of what's their natural bent in terms of their interaction and the way that they operate, and also looking at them from their skill set. But as you can see here, when you come into the technology analyst program, there's perhaps an assumption that you have a certain degree of, you know, aptitude for technology, but you're put through rigorous 15 weeks of training, and you're gonna learn very comprehensively what you need to learn in order to be effective in your profession. And so that was a long answer to a very simple question. The short answer would be no, you don't just have to have technology skills, but I think the key thing is that everything that you are as an individual comes into play when it comes to being hired at the firm. Another thing that's very important is diversity, right? Having people from different backgrounds, and it's not just, you know, ethnic diversity. It could be ethnic diversity, it could be gender diversity. It's just, you know, having people that have different experiences, that have a different way of thinking about things, coming together to share ideas and to help to formulate strategies, right? When you have that diversity of thought in the room, you get a different answer than if you have people who all have the same background, who all came from the same place, who all think the same way, right? And it's kind of the interaction between people that helps to surface the best ideas. And so that is also very, very important. Just to kind of delve into this, again, this is from the technology division standpoint. So there's application development to people who are writing programs. There's engineering, who are people who are doing things that are more supportive of the software development practice. And then there are business analysts. There are people who, and this, again, is another sort of answer to your question, that there are people in the technology division who are tax experts or who are accounting experts, and it is their knowledge of the business working together with someone who has programming skills that helps to develop the solution that's needed to build a system that can help to automate or to, you know, manage a certain function. And this is very important. So there are a lot of people who come into the technology division, as with other divisions, who are just project managers. They're people who have just really good project management skills, and they don't have technology skills at all. So whether you're a project manager, you're a business analyst, or you're someone who is more on the engineering side, there are, you know, a plethora of opportunities for people to work at the firm. Another thing that's there, there's one thing sort of entering the firm and sort of starting your job. And one of the things that I like to tell students is, when you join the firm, you are not making a lifetime decision. You're making a decision to join a firm, but you're stepping into a world that is vast. And over the life of your career, there are so many different ways that you can go. There's so many different things that you can do. And it's something that we refer to as mobility program, where someone might be in a certain job for a certain period of time. It could be, you know, a couple of years, or it could be 5 years or longer. And you know what? There's something over there in the front office trading that somehow piques their interest. Well, it's possible for you to move to an entirely different part of the business and to work in another area that's completely, you know, different from where you started. So when you come in, you're coming in, but you're stepping into a very vast world, and the options for you to move to different areas and to have unique experiences in all parts of the business is before you. So you shouldn't feel like, okay, they offered me this job and I'm making this decision and this is what I'm going to be doing for the rest of my life, because it's not like that at all. You come in and you start someplace and you use that as a point of learning and learning about the business and learning about the firm, but eventually you're going to find that, you know, your interests will lead you into other roles and responsibility as you grow in your professional career. Just want to be cognizant of the time. So, you know, this more or less speaks to what, you know, we just talked about. Here's a point that you may want to appreciate. There are there is a desire to hire students that have a strong academic foundation, and in general, the firm looks for students who have a minimum cumulative GPA of at least 3.0. And you know, that's it's not a rule, it's kind of a guideline. However, you should know that there's a high degree of competition for having the best people. And so as you're going through your career, you know, take it very seriously, and I'm sure you do. But I'm just saying it, I'm just emphasizing the need to take very seriously your academic standing, because that does factor into the selection process. Generally, a bachelor's or a master's degree in a technical major from the standpoint of the technology division, but if you're in a completely different area, whether it's tax or wealth management or accounting or finance, you know, there's going to be a technical major, meaning, you know, if, and I keep using tax as an example, but, you know, that's a, there's a lot to know about tax, right, and tax law. And so that would be considered your technical major, not computer programming and Java. You know, that, I mean, that is a technical major as well. But each area of the business has its technical major. And so whatever your passion is, and whatever, you know, your gift is, what you're bringing to the marketplace, you know, that is, it is expected that you have at least a bachelor's or master's degree in that area of knowledge. And again, you know, excellent problem solving, communication capability, teamwork, analytical skills. These are what are often referred to as soft skills, but they're not soft. In other words, you have to be able to think critically and solve problems. You're going to be presented with problems that you've never encountered before, and you have to be able to think critically about them. Your ability to communicate with others and to express not only your own ideas, but to exchange ideas with others is critically important. As I mentioned, teamwork is very, very important, because we try to bring a diverse group of people together to work as teams to solve problems, right? And to provide the services that are provided by the firm. So this is allocated to question and answer. Are there any questions? Yes.
I know you said you travel a lot. I guess, like, where's the most interesting place you ever go?
Great question. I actually, like, for many years, I was traveling to different places. I had teams in London, teams in Tokyo, and Hong Kong, had teams in India. And I actually lived in India for 2 years in Bangalore. And probably out of all the places where I've been, that was the most interesting and enriching experience, because, you know, it wasn't just like a week visit staying in a 5-star hotel, you know, but it's actually being there and living there. And when I was there, I got an opportunity to just on my own to travel around to different places like Kathmandu and across Southeast Asia, just doing trips. So that was awesome. And so having the opportunity to do that was fantastic. I have a lot of stories inside me that I can't tell you about.
I think Metro turned on their speaker, so that usually means they have a question.
Yes.
Does anybody have a question here?
Yes.
What's the work-life balance like at Morgan Stanley?
What's work-life balance?
What is it like at Morgan Stanley?
So, listen, you know, as a professional, each person has to find their balance. So there's no expectation that you work at Morgan Stanley, you have to get to work at 6 o'clock in the morning and stay there till 10 o'clock. It's not like that at all. You know, I generally come to work 8 o'clock in the morning, and I'm usually out of there somewhere around 6 p.m. While I'm there, I am engaged and I'm focused. In fact, today, in order to get here at 4:30, I had to work from home. So I'm able to log in from home and to work from home the same way I'm working in the office. And so work-life balance, from one perspective, is facilitated by the flexibility that we have in order to work. So if I have a delivery coming to my house, a furniture delivery, I can choose to work from home. Or if I have a dental appointment, I can work from home and do some work in the morning, have some meetings, go to the dentist, come back, maybe do some other things. And there's flexibility because we're professionals, right? And we work a professional day. But generally speaking, life in investment banking is intense. It's complicated. And there are, you know, very serious problems that we're working on. I will give you an example. I'm globally responsible for an area of technology called asset servicing, and this cuts across the institution as well as the wealth management business. Can anybody give me, what's your idea? Like, how much money do you think our asset servicing, and you may not know what that is, but I just want to take a guess, how much money on a monthly basis, on average, do you think is flowing through the systems that I'm responsible for? Yes.
$104 million.
More than
$10 trillion.
$10 trillion? No, a little bit less than that.
Is it too high?
Not yet. $10 trillion. I won't hold you in suspense. It's about $25 billion on average per month. Okay, so the systems that little me that I'm responsible for is processing and distributing $25 billion a month. So, guess what? If something goes wrong, that's a pretty serious problem. And so you have to make sure that things don't go wrong. And for this reason, it's complex and it's intense. So you have to be there. You have to be present, and you have to be focused while you're there. But, you know, there's leeway for you to still live your life. I get 6 weeks vacation, and I can go on vacation, you know, I can use that time. You know, if I need to take off a day to do something, like, there's flexibility because it's a professional life, but it's intense when you're there. Yes.
So with accounting, or public accounting specifically, there's a progression of roles. So usually, you know, you move up.
Yes.
But with investment banking, is that the case also, where you usually go from like one step to the other within a certain period of time?
Yes. So in each division, there is a career path. So just for example, in technology, generally you come in as what they refer to as an associate. Then you kind of become an analyst. And depending on where you are, like in India, it's a little bit different than it is in the US, but you kind of go from analyst to vice president to something called an executive director. And the next level after that is managing director. And managing director is kind of the highest level that you reach in your career. And from there, it's like the breadth of what you do expands. So you're a managing director, which means you have teams of people that you're leading, but the breadth of what you do grows over time. In other areas, you know, they have a similar progression. It's not the same in every area of discipline, but there's a similar sort of progression that generally leads to managing director, which is across the firm, the most senior level that a person generally reaches. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
And so in terms of length of time, it's a great question because there's no rule. You can be, I mean, there's a, I shouldn't say there's an expectation, but there is a historical trend, if you will, that generally speaking, you know, when you first come in, you're there for a year or two, and then you go from associate to analyst, and you could be an analyst for, there's a rule that you have to be at the firm for at least 5 years before you qualify to become a vice president. And once you're a vice president, you are generally in that role, could be 5 years, 10 years before you become an executive director. And once you reach executive director, there's a little bit of mystery and superstition that goes on, but you know, eventually you can become a managing director with that. It could be 10 more years, or it could be 2 years. It's kind of based on the impact and influence that you have in the firm. If you're someone who's generating a ton of exceptional ideas, and you're just firing all cylinders, and you're challenging the status quo, and you're coming up with innovative ways of doing things, you might make the progression to managing director much faster than someone who comes in and kind of is not that type of person. You know, in the trading organization, your progression usually is a function of how much money you make for the firm, because you're trading and you're dealing with clients and you're, you know, buying and selling securities, and you're coming up with ideas on that thing. So in each area, it's different. I made a managing director in 2008 when I was at Goldman Sachs, and then when I came to Morgan Stanley, I came in as a managing director because I was already a managing director. It took me from 1997 to 2008 to go through my career progression at Goldman Sachs, to go from, I came in as a associate, if you will, or as an analyst. I was really a project leader, but the next year I became a VP, and then, you know, it took me more or less 11 years to make managing director. And so, you know, that's just me. Like, that's not fast or slow. That's just the way it was. There's some people who it takes longer, there's some people who do it faster. And it makes a difference, because at each level of your career, you're making more and much more and more money. So can I just ask you, how much money are you expecting to make? Yeah.
$50,000 to $60,000.
So you want to start making $50,000 or $60,000, or no, you're saying that if you could make $50,000 to $60,000, you'd be like there.
Not starting, but definitely on that average in the next 5 years, maybe getting there.
Interesting. Anyone else?
Yeah. I think 50 to 60 is reasonable starting in this
okay.
profession.
All right. Anyone else? Come on. You must have a feeling about how much money you want to make. Yes.
But do you mean like starting, or do you just mean overall?
Well, let's say starting.
Starting? I guess 50 to 60 thousand.
Okay, well that's reasonable. That's very reasonable. In the technology division, students coming into the firm are, I don't know the latest numbers, but they're probably making more like $70,000 to $80,000 to start. And within a couple of years, you're making six figures, $100,000. And once you, you know, so this is not a guess on how much Dave Zebras makes, because you can't guess that. But I'm just wondering, how much do you think a person who reaches managing director might typically make?
Question over a metro thing.
Yes. Coming into the firm 50, 60, let's say 70, 80, you know, 10 years later, what do you think the potential is?
So you're asking how much I think a managing director would make?
Yeah, I mean, there's a range to everything, right? There is a base pay, and then there's this thing that they call bonus, which is a discretionary pay that you get. So I just want to take your temperature to figure out, like, how much money do you think it is?
I'd say 900,000 base salary, and then more in bonuses.
In other words, there are managing directors who have very broad responsibility, who make $1 million a year. Thank you. And there are managing directors who have less experience, who make $400,000, $500,000, $600,000, $700,000, $800,000 a year. And there are managing directors who have, you know, board level responsibility, who make $7 million a year. Okay, so I'm not saying that. I just want you to set your expectation levels around. This is why people like working in investment banking, they like that. Because you can actually make a reasonable amount of money. And what I'm saying to you is, think six figures. Set your sights higher. $50,000, $60,000 is good money. Don't get me wrong, that's really good money. But if you're talking about being in this industry with the amount of pressure that's put on you, you know, the reality is that people generally get paid six figures, and it could be $150,000 and up.
I don't mean to cut you off, but we're actually supposed to be out of this room. Yeah.
Okay, good. Thank you.
Hey everyone, make sure that you sign the attendance sheet if you already have it. Another reminder is that we'll be having a volunteering opportunity April 8th from 11 to 2 at the Great Swamp Refuge in Harding. Again, it's a really easy way to get your 3 hours. It'll count toward tutoring, pretty much. The other thing is that make sure if you are a member or a candidate, your name is going to be highlighted on that sheet that I shared with you guys on Google Drive. If it is, you need to make sure that you see Sandra and you schedule time for tutoring. And then the final thing is we have pizza in the back. Thank you so much for sponsoring it.
Yep.
And that's pretty much it. Again, any questions, just email vapfdu@gmail.com.